I know most everybody here does not know the prayers, so if you can bring them with you every day, then we can say them together. The purpose of these prayers, the purpose of these prayers, welcome.
The purpose of these prayers is that we're invoking auspiciousness for the meeting. Because if you're depending on me, then don't hold your breath for the auspiciousness of this meeting. So what we're doing is we're calling out to Guru, Vaishnavas, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his associates, Radha and Krishna and their associates, that they bring all goodness and take away all obstacles in our realizing the message of this course, which is Sri Bhajan Rahasya by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. So how many of you have the prayers with you? How many of you have the prayers at home and you just forgot them? So I'll Xerox a couple, some for the new people, and those who already have it can bring it next time. Alright, so we'll say these prayers together. Abhyanam timirandasya jnananjana sabhaya chakshurun militam yena tasmai shri gurave gurave gaurachandraya pradikayai sadalaye krishnaya krishna bhaktaya tada bhaktaya namo namah yam pravrachanta manupetam apetam krityam dvaipayano viraha in the dust of the lotus feet of my most worshipful Diksha Gurudev, Nichalila Pravishta Om Vishnu Pai, Astotra Sat Shri Srimad. Madhavi, you sit next to Snigdha. This is Madhavi, she's Russian. Right here. Snigdha's the translator. What are we up to? I also offer my unlimited obeisances in the dust of the lotus feet of my most worshipful Shiksha Gurudev, Nityalila Pravishta Om Vishnu Pad, Astotra Sat Shri Srimad, Srila Bhakti Vedanta Narayan Goswami Maharaj, to Srila Bhakti Vigyan Bharati Goswami Maharaj, to all of our Guru Varga, and all the assembled devotees. Damodar Prabhu, can I have those prayers? I'm going to quickly summarize the meaning of the prayers. And I would like to say that Gurudev informed us that if we don't know the translations of what we're saying, then it's just like sense gratification. We don't get, we may get some impressions, sukritis, for later in this life or a future life, but it's not real bhakti. So the first is I'm offering obeisances to Gurudev, who opens my eyes with the torchlight of knowledge, which has been blinded by the darkness of ignorance. So we're asking him to give us those eyes during this meeting of hearing about Bhaktivinoda Thakur's mercy upon us. Actually, this book is a meditation book. To run through it in a course, of course, doesn't at all do it justice. Practically every verse is for meditating on, and especially the verses that we'll be discussing today in chapter 3, which is the verse correlating with the stage of nistha, or steadiness in bhakti, and which correlates with the verse in Shikshastakam, Trinadapi Sunichena, that is, one should become lower than the straw on the street, feel lower than the straw on the street, more tolerant than a tree, should give all respects to others without desiring any respects to ourself. That's what this whole chapter 3 is about that we'll be discussing today. And it's practically all prayers. So we'll all be reading together. So this next prayer, Guruve Guru Chandraya, is by our Param Gurudev Srila Bhakti Pragyan Kesava Goswami Maharaj, which includes a call of appeal to everybody, to Guru, to Gora, to Radhika, to her associates, to Krishna, to all of his bhaktas, and all of their bhaktas. Then the next prayer is to Sukadeva Goswami, that he's entered into the hearts of all beings, and he left home as an 11-year-old boy, as soon as he came out of the womb of his mother, without having undergone any reformatory processes, because he was already perfect. And his father called out, oh son, where are you, as he left home. But only the trees echoed in response to the father's call. Why? Because Sukadeva Goswami was fully renounced. So we won his mercy, his renunciation, and we want to be recipients of his compassion, because out of his causeless mercy to help the fallen souls to cross over the ocean of nescience, he recited the Srimad Bhagavatam. And he's so powerful, just like the super soul, that he can enter into everyone's heart. And then we pray to Vrindadevi, which all of these verses fit perfectly with today's chapter, which is the Trinadapi verse. O Vrindadevi, devoid of any bhakti, guilty of unlimited offenses, tossed by the turbulent waves of lust, anger, greed, pride, illusion, and envy, I have no shelter unless you give me your shelter. Then we pray to Radharani, I'm yours, I'm only yours. Understanding this, please bring me to the abode of your lotus feet. So Gurudev says that all of our acharyas utter these prayers before their class. Sukadeva Goswami in the Srimad Bhagavatam gave a whole chapter of prayers before answering the questions of Maharaj Parikit. It's because he's calling for his superiors to decorate his tongue with the proper words and the proper realization. So I think at least one third of you all are new in this class. So I'll quickly summarize what the class is all about. Also, we need to kind of dust ourselves off because we haven't had this class in about 5 days. So for everybody, we'll summarize what the class is about and what we have already discussed. Those who've been here before already have a Xerox copy of this chart, which is a summary of the book. Because the book is very, very complex and superimposing and overlapping and correlating many topics upon each other. So for those who are new, we'll have these Xeroxed for you by tomorrow's class. So what we have is, in this book, we have 8 chapters. Each chapter corresponds with a particular time of day of Radha and Krishna's eightfold pastimes. For example, today's chapter 3, corresponds with Radha and Krishna's 4 noon pastimes. When Krishna is leaving home after breakfast to, that is 8:30 in the morning till about 11 o'clock in the morning. When he leaves home and his parents can't bear to give him up for a few hours. So they're kind of slowly following him and talking with him, and he's trying to tell them that we're fine, don't worry about us. We have everything we need in the forest, and his mother's worried that, well, there are thorns and you're not wearing any shoes, at least put on some shoes. And Krishna said, when the cows wear shoes, then I'll wear shoes. When they have an umbrella, that's when I'll have an umbrella. And so finally he convinced them to be pacified and to go home. And then his real ambition in going to the forest, of course, as you know, is to meet with the gopis. Because it's difficult to meet in their home except at mealtime, breakfast, when Radharani is in the kitchen cooking. So in the meantime, after breakfast, so these verses, which summarize the pastimes of Radha and Krishna, during this time, in this chapter, for example, chapter 3, are the 4 noon pastimes of about 8:30 in the morning till about 11 o'clock in the morning. So these verses about their summary of their daytime pastimes and nighttime pastimes are the introductory verses of each time of day written in the Govinda Lilamrita by Srila Krishna Das Kaviraj Goswami, who's also, fortunately for us, the author of Chaitanya Charitamrita, our life source and substance. So, first, he's meditating on Krishna, who's going out in the forest with the cows, and then I meditate on Radha after she prepares breakfast and after Mother Yasoda feeds her and her sakis breakfast. She goes home and her mother-in-law, Jutila, order her to go out into the forest to Surya Kund and worship the sun god for the economic benefit of the family, so that they'll have very good cows and lots of wealth. So Radharani's so-called husband, Abhimanyu, can have happiness for his well-being. So she goes out ostensibly to worship the sun, but really she's waiting for Krishna, and she's sent out her sakis to look for him, to see on which path he'll be coming. And so she's very restlessly waiting for them to return to let her know when and from where Krishna is coming to meet. So this third chapter corresponds to this third time of day of Radha and Krishna's pastimes. It also corresponds to the third verse of Shikshastakam, which we sang Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur's song expanding the meaning of. I think you all know the verse. Trinadapi Sunichena, Tarodavi Sahishnana, Amanina, Manadena, Kirtinaya, Siddhahari. And then this song, I'll read the translation. That's why we come at 11:15, so that we can take the time to comfortably sing the songs of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, which correspond to the particular chapter that we'll be studying that day. And also it corresponds to the particular stage of bhakti, which correlates with that chapter. So the stage of bhakti, there are, I think, 9 stages. First is ado, which means first. Ado means first, or beginning with. But ado is actually a very long meaning. It means the millions of births that it's taken you to, that you've been performing spiritual pious activities, had little drops of devotee association, so that finally you come to sadhu sangha and have good extensive association, through which you come to the stage of shraddha, or faith, that if I simply serve Krishna, all my, everything else that I was thinking about doing, and every other duty that I have, is automatically taken care of. Just as by watering the root of the tree, all the leaves and branches are watered, and by feeding the stomach, all the organs of the body are nourished. So that stage that corresponds with this verse is nistha. First comes a little bit of sadhu sangha, a little bit of good sukritis and sanskars, then shraddha in sadhu sangha, good association, at which time my anarthas start, or unwanted habits and thoughts, attachment to useless things, envy, desire for prestige, confusion about the goal and how to get there, confusion about who is God and who am I and what is our relationship, offenses, and things like that. Those are all anarthas which start going away in sadhu sangha. And then one comes to this stage that we'll be discussing today of nistha, where more anarthas go away, distractions in chanting and remembering become alleviated. Otherwise, previous to nistha, I'm starting to chant, and by the end of my chanting, I don't know where my mind was all that time. Or I'm chanting Gayatri, I begin with and then when I'm at the last prachodaya, I don't know where I was during that entire time. At the stage of steadiness, these distractions and other thoughts coming in become greatly diminished. This is a stage also where one sincerely surrenders. As he's becoming free from offenses, he's able to surrender. And we'll discuss the limbs of surrender or sharanagati after we read this translation. The whole chapter is about this translation, so it's very significant. If you wish to engage, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is saying, if you wish to engage your mind in the performance of Sri Krishna Kirtan, then you must very carefully earn the required spiritual qualification to be able to chant. And what is that? Relinquishing false pride, which includes I am this body, I'm a lady or a man, or I have a certain position, I'm a brahmana, I'm a kshatriya. The pride of mundane identity, the pride of abilities, beauty. There are 4 kinds of opulences, like beauty, wealth, good birth, and what else? knowledge. Huh? And what? It's not one of the four. So giving up those prides, always considering one's yourself more lowly and insignificant than a blade of grass. I remember in 1966, our first ISKCON Temple president, Brahmananda, he asked Prabhupada, as Prabhupada was discussing this verse, how can I possibly, I mean, he's like a really big person anyway, tall and very heavy set. He said, how can I think of myself as more tiny and insignificant than a blade of grass? So Prabhupada said, because you are. The soul is, if you take the tip of the hair and you break it into 1,000 pieces, and then you take one of those pieces, 10,000, 100, well, it's 1,000, and then...
First 100, then another 100.
How many comes to, does that come to 10,000? Okay, so you break it into 100, and then you break one of those parts into 100, that comes to 1/10,000th, the tip of the hair. It's called 1/10,000th, the tip of the hair, but it's so small, actually, that it can't be measured. So thinking oneself more insignificant than a blade of grass, destitute and worthless. Cultivate forbearance like that of a tree, that is being in the mood of giving no matter what anybody else does, not being on the competition circle. Well, I gave you something, I gave you two things, but you only gave me one thing. Now you owe me something before I'm going to give you something again. But a tree doesn't have any consideration. Even if a, what do you call this? Wood chopper? Wood cutter? Comes to cut down the tree. Still the tree offers that wood cutter its shade, its bark, its fruits, its flowers, its fragrance. Forsaking retaliation, nurture and support others. I think you all know the story of the two saints who went to the river to take water. And one of them was taking water and he saw as he was taking water that there was a scorpion that was drowning. So he picked up the scorpion, but the nature of a scorpion is that he likes to bite. So the scorpion bit him and he got bloody. And then the scorpion jumped out of his hand. And he picked the scorpion up again to save him. And that happened a couple of more times. And then his friend said, what are you doing? Why are you wasting your time saving this scorpion? Look how he's reciprocating with you. So then the saint said, actually, he's my guru because he's teaching me, don't change your nature under any circumstance. Just as he's not changing his nature, no matter how nice I am, I'm a saint. I'm supposed to be a saint. Why should I change my nature just because he's doing something to me? So, forsaking retaliation, nurture and support others. Like our Prabhupada gives the example of a doctor who's treating a patient, perhaps performing an operation, and the patient is in pain and he's kicking and cursing the doctor, but the doctor doesn't take it personally and he continues treating that patient. Then next verse, in the course of leading your life, do not give anxiety to anyone else. And this means Dhanapat Maharaj. Do not give anxiety to others by your body, mind or words, and forget your own comfort. Then next translation, even if you are a great soul endowed with all good qualities, relinquish the desire for honor. The explanation of this, or let's say better, the example of this, is Maharaj Prithu, who was coming into his kingdom, and he was being honored by all of his citizens, but he wasn't at all affected by that, receiving that honor. And the analogy is given that a tree, which is full of, this is another tree analogy, not the same, the tree that's full with fruits and flowers is always hanging down low because of the weight of the fruits and flowers, always low. But a tree that has no good qualities like that, it's a bare tree, he's always standing up straight. Here I am. So even if endowed with all good qualities, relinquish the desire for honor and make your heart humble. Next translation. Knowing Sri Krishna to be situated in the heart of all living beings, always respect according to one's position and show affection to all. That is in another one of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur's prayers. He begs Guru and Vaishnavas, please teach me the qualities of the different kinds of Vaishnavas so I can understand how to honor them according to what they deserve. At the same time, here we are requested to honor all more than us. Even if I have all good qualities, and even if I'm advanced, and even if someone else is new and kanista, in my heart I'm offering that person respect and not desiring respect from that person, even though a neutral person may see me as more advanced. Knowing Sri Krishna to be situated in the hearts of all beings, always respect and show affection to all. It's stated in the third canto that one who does not show respect to the Lord, situated in the heart of all beings, his worship of the deity and performance of fire sacrifices is just like throwing grains. You know how you throw grains in the fire? Well, his throwing of grains is like throwing grains into the ashes. It doesn't have any effect. Endowed with the four qualities of humility, compassion, respect, and modesty, perform kirtan of the Lord. Then, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he's weeping because he's considering himself, who's the most advanced, who's a manifestation of Gadadhar Pandit, who's personally Srimati Radhika herself. But and they're not pretending. He's weeping at the feet of the Lord, and he's praying, oh, when will you give me such qualification? So, in each chapter of Bhajan Rahasya, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur has chosen select verses from various scriptures to be that particular verse in any chapter. And then he explains that particular verse in his own corresponding Bengali verses. And then in our Srila Gurudev's Vritti, Sri Bhajan Rahasya Vritti, or commentary, Srila Gurudev further expands on Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur's commentary. So in text number 2 of this third chapter, which is Trinada Pisunichena, third chapter, which corresponds with a certain portion of the first verse of Shikshastika. The first verse of Shikshastika describes the 7 excellent results of chanting the holy names. And the second phrase, First, as you know, we begin Chaito Darpana Marjanam, which means the first installment of the chanting is that it cleanses the heart of all the dust accumulated for years together. No matter how many sins one could possibly commit over many millions of births, the chanting of the Hare Krishna mantra, when chanted at least in Namabhas, it gets rid of all those sinful reactions. Then the second phrase, Bhava Mahadabhagni Nirvapanam. So this phrase, the second excellent result, meaning that the chanting extinguishes the blazing fire of material existence, that corresponds with this stage of bhakti called nista. And it also corresponds with this third verse of Shikshastika. As we discussed... Thank you. Bhava Maha Davagni Nirvapana. Well, according to the chart... According to the chart, our numbers get overlapped. The second phrase of the first verse corresponds with the third verse of Shikshastakam. And it also corresponds with the third time of day of Radha and Krishna's pastimes. And it corresponds, that's right, thank you. So there are eight chapters in this book. There are eight pairs of the Hare Krishna mantra. One pair is Hare Krishna, and then Hare Krishna, and then Krishna Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna.
And that also corresponds with the separation and meeting pastimes of Radha and Krishna. And this Krishna Krishna corresponds with Trinadapi. And it also corresponds with separation because Krishna is with Krishna, it's not with Radha. So in this second text, as I mentioned, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur begins by quoting appropriate verses that help us understand the first verse, which is Trinadapi. So this, at this stage of nista, at this stage of humility, something comes, and that's called Sharanagati. On one hand, we hear that Sharanagati is not bhakti itself, but it's a doorway to bhakti. At the same time, Sharanagati is a very high principle, and it's also within the 64 limbs of bhakti. And it also corresponds, the mood of the devotee in Sharanagati corresponds with the mood of humility in this verse under discussion. That is to accept everything favorable in his humility, in his sense of worthlessness, in his sense of thinking that he has no qualities and no level of bhakti whatsoever. He only wants to accept, and with his eagerness for bhakti, he only accepts those activities, persons, associations, subject matters of discussion, like I could be really sick today, and that's all I really want to talk about. But that's not favorable for my chanting of the Hare Krishna mantra, and it's not favorable for my advancement in bhakti. In fact, the fact that I'm conscious of that, of how sick I am, rather than being conscious of the glory of the Lord, is due to illusion and turning away from him and not being surrendered. Not being surrendered to the remembering the glories of the Lord and chanting the glories of the Lord are the cause of being tormented by anxieties. Within the concept of Sharanagati, the main concept, actually the, the intrinsic quality of Sharanagati or surrender is thinking that Krishna is my only maintainer. And I'm not thinking, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur and Gurudev explain here, I'm not thinking that Krishna has sent me this to this world to suffer and be miserable. Rather, I'm thinking that I'm the cause, I've chosen to be miserable by turning away from the Lord. Just as my hand, when it's facing the light, is in the light, and when it's facing away from the light, it's in the darkness. So I have that choice to turn to or to turn away. So to accept everything favorable for Krishna Bhakti and for chanting the holy name of the Lord, to reject everything unfavorable, to have the strong faith that Krishna is my maintainer. So that's the intrinsic, or the Swarup Lakshana, or in English, the intrinsic quality of surrender. And the marginal symptoms of surrender are all the other five limbs of surrender. That is thinking Krishna's my protector, always being meek and humble so that Krishna will take care of me, making my desire one with Krishna's desire. The epitome of this is Srimati Radhika. Of course, when Gurudev was asked once in Australia, so Radharani is the most surrendered to Krishna? And Gurudev replied in his typical form as a Manjari, why should she surrender to him? He should surrender to her. He should do samarpan, full surrender, at her feet. But anyway, she is the epitome of these qualities. And she's thinking, if Krishna's unhappy, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur explains this, if Krishna's gets his happiness by not appearing before me, then that's my happiness. Because one of the symptoms of surrender is to make my desire, in fact it's the last symptom, to make my desire one with the desire of Krishna. So if his desire is that I'm suffering at the moment, then I'm not going to fight it. I'll be happy that it's happening on a physical level, or there's some loss. And one of the symptoms of surrender is to see equally loss and gain. Why? Because I want bhakti. And it explains here that Krishna never appears in the heart of one who is affected by material loss or gain. So to make my desire the same as Krishna. So Radharani is thinking, and Vilva Mangala Thakur in his Krishna Karnamrita is offering a prayer in the mood of Srimati Radhika. That is, if Krishna's happy to not be present before me, then even the endeavors of my sakis to search for him and find him and bring him to me will not make me happy, because my desire is his happiness. So that's atma samarpana on our part, to be fully self-surrendered to his desire and make that our desire. Also, there are four things that happen at this time of these four qualities, Trinadapi Sunichana. So four symptoms happen. And this is described in Bhaktivinoda Thakur's commentary to text number one. And that is the natural humility that comes to the devotee at the stage of nistha is born from his detachment to sense objects. Otherwise, this is, I am this body and everything in relation to this body is mine, is exactly opposite to humility. And then the second thing, that compassion comes. So something comes as something goes. Humility comes when attachment to material objects, material relationships, parents, sons, spouses, and objects of possession. When that, as that goes, humility comes. Compassion comes as one becomes devoid of envy. And then purity of heart comes as one becomes free from false ego. And respect towards everyone comes according to that person's position. And to understand another person's position is not an easy thing, and it requires the mercy of the Lord and a certain level of advancement. Actually, really understanding the position of others comes when, a little bit later in the game, when we're at the stage of asakti, which is the stage sort of madhyama-madhyama. And at that stage, one can make a distinction between those who are in his behavior towards others. He knows how to serve those who are superior, be friendly, and share with those who are equal, be friendly and give nectar and compassion to those who are subordinate, and to avoid those who are envious of bhakti, Bhagavan, and bhakta. Okay, so then he's going on to the next verse.
What comes with freedom from false ego?
Freedom from false ego is, see, the first is
purity
of heart. Thank you.
So quoting more verses.
In humility, he's quoting a verse from Mukhotra.
Which page in the book?
This is page 134, which our Srila Prabhupada used to sing so beautifully. Krishna tadiya pada pankaja panjarantam adaiva visitumi manasaraja hamsa prana prayana samaye kavabata pitu kanta bara do bhajanam kutaste krishna tadiya pada pankaja panjarantam. So the meaning of this is that my request is that the swan of my mind be confined in the cage of your lotus feet and dwell there in the ocean of rasa. At the time of death, one's throat becomes choked up with mucus, bile, and air. All the life airs are discombobulated. So how, when I can barely think because everything is so filled up with mucus and bile, how will I be able to remember you? So he's praying that let me die now, when I'm in strong body, strong mind, and I can easily remember you. Then there's about six other verses that Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is quoting from that same Jamuna's Stotra by Jamunacharya. There are six very, very beautiful prayers of humility. That's why I say it's difficult to do a course or to go through this book quickly. Of course, we can read it from end to end, but actually it's a meditation book. And practically every verse is a prayer. So these prayers In this chapter are all prayers of humility, where Jamanacharya, as you've heard about him the last couple of nights from Srila Bharati Maharaj, how he became, he was first a pauper, then a great king, very attached, then he became a great devotee. I'm not devoted to Dharma, nor do I have any knowledge of the soul, and my heart has no devotion to your lotus feet. O protector, being destitute, I take shelter of you. Here's, just to interrupt myself for a moment, here's a way that we try to enjoy due to false ego and due to attachment to the mind's activity. We're hearing Harikatha from a pure devotee, and then more people start coming in, and I start watching the other people come in and giving my mental comments about each person who comes in. That person's not a good devotee, that person is this and that person is kind of offensive, and that person is a nice devotee, and look what they're wearing. And meanwhile, I've missed 5, 10, 15 minutes of the Harikatha. So this is like against the principle of these four items of Trinadapi Sunichena. It's trying to enjoy the activities of this mind, which is not me, as we read in the previous chapter, in the second yam, the second stage of bhakti, anartha nivritti and sadhu sangha. At that stage, I start understanding that, very beginning of understanding that I'm not mine. And the development of that understanding comes in subsequent stages. My possessions don't belong to me. I don't belong to me, and my mind doesn't belong to me. My body doesn't belong to me. Therefore, I use everything for the pleasure of the Lord. So, my heart has no devotion to your lotus feet. O protector, being destitute, I take shelter of you. I have no shelter other than you. You have come as the savior of the fallen to deliver such a wretched soul as me. And I'm sure you're all thinking now that practically all the songs in our Vaishnava songbook are in this very mood. Songs to Guru, songs to Vaishnava, songs to Gopinath, songs to Mahaprabhu. I'm your eternal servant and you're my eternal master. So one after another. Then Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur quotes a very important verse from Srimad Bhagavatam. This is on page 139. And our Srila Prabhupada also sings this beautifully, that when will I have, as Gurudev said, the most important word in our vocabulary is when. Oh, when. When will I think of myself as your servant and take pleasure in the ocean of rust that resides there in that mentality? All mental creations and desires are alleviated and the mind is pacified by uninterrupted service. If my mind is agitated, if I'm feeling incomplete, if I'm feeling frustrated, it's only due to that hand turning away. What's the first verse in, Purnam Adaha Purnamidam? The Supreme Lord is perfect and complete. Because he's completely perfect, so many complete units, including this phenomenal cosmic manifestation, although so many complete units like this cosmic manifestation emanate from him, he remains the complete balance. All sense of incompleteness is due to incomplete knowledge of the complete whole, incomplete connection. when my hand is connected with my body. If something's wrong with my hand, I'm prepared to spend millions of dollars to operate on it. I'll sell my house, everything. But if my hand is disconnected from my body, then I throw it and kick it, and so would everybody else. Lying in the street, it's useless. People would be scared and run away. So all sense of incompleteness is due to incomplete knowledge, which gives connection, incomplete connection of the complete whole. So when will I be designated as your eternal servant? When will I be radiant with joy, having obtained such a competent master as you? So that's praying for the positive in humility. And then in humility, there's a most amazing verse. I hope I can find it. Text number 3. We're going back, because this is a verse of what I want to give up, what I want to see this body as, and the disgust that I want to feel at having so much attachment for the disgusting body. Idam sariram satasandhi jarjaram patyanta vasyam parinama peshavam kemanusam prachyati muda dormate niramayam krishna rasayanam piva. We have the embodiment of memory of all verses. This frail body, which is made of 5 elements and connected by hundreds of joints, is certain to decline. Consequently, the body will be burned to ashes, or will become food for worms and transformed into excrement. Excrement means like stool. Our Prabhupada was once giving a class at a university in 1969 in Boston, and he said, this body, which you are soaping so nicely, will turn into 3 things at death. That is, ashes, stool, or, what's the last thing? Depending on your religion. Worms will come out of it.
Worms.
So consequently, the body will be burnt to ashes, or will become food for worms, or transformed into excrement. O foolish and wicked mind, you have decorated such a disgusting body with a senseless attachment. The elixir of Krishna Nam is the only powerful medicine to cure this disease of material existence. You should constantly drink it by incessantly chanting Krishna's holy name. So very, very beautiful verses. Another 2 verses that Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur gives reference to in relation to Sharanagati, which comes with humility, is verse 2 and verse 3 of Sri Upadeshamrita. One is what to give up, because the first quality of anukulyasya sankalpa, accepting everything favorable for Krishna Bhajan and rejecting everything unfavorable. We gave our Srila Prabhupada's analogy in the last class, that if you want to go on a airplane, if you buy your ticket ahead of time, then you go to the airport without anxiety. If you didn't buy your ticket on time and you're on standby, you're in a lot of anxiety, and you may just end up miserable because there's no seat. So similarly, when we do Krishna Bhajan, when we do Harinam, then if we prepared, then we'll be able to do it nicely. And all the preparations are given here by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. So the second and third verses of Upadeshamrita are what I want to give up and what I want to do. Six things that I want to give up that are bad for my bhakti, and six things that I want to do. So what are the bad things that I want to give up? Unhelpful. What is verse number two? Atyahara prayasas cha prajalpo niyamagraha janasangas chalolam cha sadhir bhakti vinashiti. We discussed this verse at length in the last class, giving up not only collecting too much for my tongue, speaking prajalpo, but collecting with all my senses. I want to touch this nice thing, I want to see that nice thing for my own enjoyment, associating with people who are not helpful to my bhakti. So I won't elaborate on it here, but here again Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is bringing those verses up for what, because it fits with now Sharanagati. And then what do I want to do? What six things do I want to do? What's the third verse of Upadeshamrita? Utsaha nischayed, which means enthusiasm. Following the religious principles according to whether I am a grihastha or renunciate. I follow those predecessors who I want to be like. And what else?
Confidence
that I'm trying my best and Krishna will give me the result. My Gurudev will give me the result. Confidence, what else? Patience. Not being discouraged or disturbed when there's a delay in success, because success is sure for the rigid practitioner. Then?
Favorable activities.
Yeah, I mean this verse. Which means?
Giving up things that are unavailable. Adopting things that are favorable.
Maharaj, can you be more specific?
Tat karma pravartanat. You know better than anyone.
Tat means according to
what duty is described in various scriptures, have to follow that.
According to whether I'm renunciate,
then I want to. Any ashram. According to varna and ashram, what duty has prescribed in various scriptures, we have to follow that.
Thank you. Tat means according to that.
Yeah.
Tat. Like tat, what is it? Tat bhavi ichamai. Right, according to what the manjaris do, I do. Okay, so we want to go to the end of the chapter, which is the pastimes of Radha and Krishna at that time of day. So I'll read that. Actually, we already discussed it. We discussed, I meditate on Krishna doing this, I meditate on Radharani doing that. And now we'll just read Srila Gurudev's commentary on Radha and Krishna's pastimes. This is called Purvahana Lila, the third yam, the third time of day of Radha and Krishna. After Krishna has eaten, he prepares to go to the forest wearing the attire of a coward boy. And Sri Vrishabhanu Nandini, decorated with cloth and ornaments given by Sri Jashoda, returns to Dyavat. They meet halfway. Upon seeing Sri Radha, Krishna's peacock feather falls from his head and his flute slips from his hand. This pastime is described in the following verse of Sri Radha Rasa Sudaniti. Venum karam nipatitam skalitam sikandam Prastham chapita vasanam prajarajasunam. Then?
Sakatakcha sarabhata vimurchitasya
Tanradika parichadam
Sadarasena.
When, O Radha, will I serve you Sadarasena with Ras? Means with the mood of a maidservant. Seeing you as Krishna is seeing you. Sometimes Srila Gurudev explains this verse when Krishna is first going cowherding and Radha and Krishna are sharing stealthy glances and all the his family members are there watching him. And Krishna's flute falls from his hands, his pitambara starts falling from his shoulders. And Madhu Mangala is saying, Krishna, this is not the time to faint. Your relatives are all here. It's not the time that your pitambara should fall from your shoulders. So, that's the meaning of this verse. And, prastham chapita vasanam raja raja suno. Then what's the third line?
Jasha
kataksha
vimurchita
saragatasya. That is, why does that happen to him? By the sidelong glance of Srimati Radhika, he begins to faint. Same thing with another verse, Yo Brahma Rudra Sukhanarada Visma Mukhyai. That is, that Krishna, which is barely or rarely or never fully seen by Brahma, Shiva, Narada, Sukha, and Bhishma Dev, he's fully controlled by the sidelong glance of Srimati Radhika. So now it's 12 o'clock. We finished the third verse, third chapter. And we can move on to the fourth chapter, which is the fourth stage of advancement in bhakti, which is ruchi. A taste is beginning to come for bhajan. In the stage of ruchi, as in the stage of nista, bhakti has not yet taken over the heart. That starts coming in asakti, when there's a semblance of heart melting. Real heart melting comes in bhava bhakti, when ecstatic symptoms come underway, and full heart melting comes in prem, in pure love, when one has a very intense identification that Krishna is my lover, or Krishna is my son, Krishna is mine. In the stage of bhava bhakti, the beginning of those identifications come, the beginning of the ecstatic symptoms come, and the beginning of seeing myself in the pastimes as my siddhadeha allows me to meditate on my service. The semblance of that comes when the semblance or shadow reflection of my spiritual body is beginning to manifest in my heart, and that is at the stage of asakti, attachment, when tears are real. Before that, as Gurudev explained, the tears are crocodile tears. One moment I'm crying as I'm singing or chanting in appreciation, and the next moment, you didn't do what I said, I'm going to break your leg. Don't you realize who I am? I'm angry at somebody. So in this stage of ruchi, it's bhakti and the holy name still has not come in my heart. I'm still on the stage of intelligence, but there's taste. At the same time, first the taste, if everything is nice, like the deities are nicely dressed, if the singer is good, And then in the later stage, it doesn't matter. Have a taste anyway. So this verse of the 12, of the fourth stage of the fourth time of day of Radha and Krishna, when they're enjoying pastimes at Radhakund, where they're enjoying pastimes on the swing, enjoying gambling, enjoying water sports. At that time of Radha and Krishna's day, that correlates with the next phrase of the first verse of Shikshastikam, which is Sreya Koirava Chandrika Vataranam Cheto Darpana Marjanam Bhava Mahadavagni Nirvapanam Sreya Koirava Chandrika Vataranam. Okay, so at that time, the blooming white lotus of auspiciousness is starting to blossom in my heart. And at that stage, I become free from material desires. It's not fully, because at this stage of taste, of ruchi, it's a semblance of anyabhilasita sunyam, which means absolutely no material desires. My only desire is to satisfy Krishna, and all the cultivation of all my activities is for his satisfaction. Plus, I know what he wants. So in order to know what he wants, I have to get reflections of his form and pastimes in my heart. So I must be coming at least an asakti. But there's a very strong beginning of that in the stage of taste or ruchi. Nandanam najanam. O Lord, I have no desire for wealth, means any possessions, or no attachment that this is my family and this is not my family. Now I'm starting to identify as the family of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. More so, as you see, all the Gaudiya Mutts were joining together. Gurudev said it's a poison that comes in to misconception of the verse, the verses describing what is a Mahatma. He's described in Srimad Bhagavatam that if you serve the Mahatma, then the door to liberation is open. And by serving those involved in sense gratification, then my door to hell is open, to the darkest region of ignorance. So the qualities of such a Mahatma for serving is given in the Bhagavatam. To Tikshava, Karunika, he's tolerant, he's merciful, he's equal to all, he's friendly to everyone, he has no desires, compassionate. So Gurudev said a poison has come in, and we're thinking that Mahatma means somebody from my institution. So it was so lovely to see all the institutions of the Gaudiya Mutts joining together for that lovely festival and hearing the different speakers saying, beginning their speeches by saying, I offer my obeisances to my Gurudev, and each Gurudev had a different name. Sri Rup Siddhanti, then our Pujapad Madhav Maharaj, our Gurudev, another one was Srila Bhakti Balatirtha Goswami Maharaj, very nice. So, and then on a larger level, because he's already has the qualities of Trinadipi Sunichena, he sees the Lord manifest in everyone's heart, and therefore he shows affection to all, even an ant, even that scorpion, even a grass. At least with his intelligence, he sees Krishna in all, and he's affectionate to all. I'm kind of like a perverted reflection of that. Sometimes when I would throw whatever prasadam I couldn't take, and I would throw it in the garbage, then I would think, I would try to be like that, and or imitate that, and I would think, I'm not throwing out prasadam, I'm distributing prasadam to the incense and bacteria in the garbage, or wherever it's going next. Nasundarin Kavita. I have no attraction for reading mundane literature or hearing mundane poetry or what to speak of, just mundane prajalpa. In the previous class, which was the previous stage, the second verse of Shikshastika, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur was quoting Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, that all of your powers, all of your mercy, all of your beauty, everything is there in the holy name. In innumerable universes are in each of your pores, and that power is there in the holy name. Because it's not that Krishna is in his holy name, but the holy name is Krishna. So, as Gurudev says at initiations, Krishna's holy name has the power to create universes in 1 second, destroy them in the next second, and recreate them in the next second. But Durdoiva Major Samehajani Na Anuraga, Na Anuraga. I have no attachment, as unfortunate as I am. So Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur quoted many, many verses. How to be free from that Durdoiva. What prayers to say while chanting and while not chanting. For example, he quoted the Manishiksha prayers. O mind, give up attachment, or O mind, how can pure love, pristine divine love, enter my heart when the audacious dog-eating woman of the desire for fame is audaciously dancing there? Please call out to the commanders-in-chief in the army of Krishna, who is in charge of Krishna, the path of Krishna Bhakti. They will immediately kick out that prostitute, and they will immediately initiate the flow of divine love in your heart. And oh mind, you are constantly drinking the hot urine of the donkey of full-blown deceit and hypocrisy. And you're burning, incinerating the both of us. So stop this, and instead, resuscitate my being and bathe me in the nectar, pastimes, and glories of Gandharvika Girihari, Sri Sri Radha, and Krishna, and refresh me. So this whole book is really a book of so many prayers at so many different stages. So now it's 5 minutes to the time we end the class. So I'm going to ask if there's any questions or comments, any ifs, ands, or buts, any additions or subtractions. Yes, Cricket Purple.
On those
louder.
Discussing those points of progression from Mr. Rich, etc. I was always curious why. I think it's interesting, Chandra, because Krishnadas Kaviraj wrote, using the word nishta, nishta hoila upajaya, prema rataranga, when their steadiness comes, when that nishta is there, that waves of love, waves of praying start to flow, he said. And I was always curious why he used that, expressed it that way, when really your analysis, as you presented, I thought was exactly as I understood it. But that particular verse always troubled me, thinking why he used the word nishta. And I wondered if he was just using it in a general sense, some kind of steadiness and bhakti had come, you know? I was always confused by that.
But you're talking about Madhurya Kadamani?
I can't remember where that verse comes from. Nishta Hoila Upajaya. I thought it was Krishnadas Kaviraj. And he says, when that steadiness comes, when that nishta is there, the waves of love start to flow. This is what the verse says.
Can you explain that, Maharaj?
Mention nishtha hoite upajay premer taranga. So once Srila Gurudev was explaining, prior to nishtha it called brahmi sthiti. when Brahmi sthiti is there with some sadhak not reach nishtha yet, up to that point so many can give up Krishna consciousness, can take again non-veg, may drink, may smoke. But when nishtha will come, then is never give up Krishna consciousness. So nishtha is the foundation or base. So when foundation strong, then gradually we can build multi-storied building. Our aim of our bhajan is achieve Krishna prem. So this is the base, nishtha, foundation. When nishtha is there, one day, may take time, but one day must, the waves of prem will come and dance in our heart.
Oh, so it doesn't mean now.
Yeah,
no.
So that's a good reconciliation.
Yeah, thank you. Happy with that.
So, Ganesh,
louder.
So, Ganesh Dadikari question, because Ganesh Dasar confused. You said it might be agitated, frustrated, incomplete. That's due to not being fully engaged in service. That part I can understand. But the next you mentioned was all sense of incompleteness is due to being incomplete. So how to understand that Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, for example, says I'm lower than worm in a stool, it's being.
Well, the phrase in the verse about all sense of incompleteness is the end of the first verse of Isopanishad. The verse is explaining the nature of the complete whole, Om Purnamada Purnamidam, that he's so perfect and complete that even if so many complete units come from him, like no matter how many rays, no matter how much heat and light has been coming from the sun since the beginning of time, it hasn't gotten colder and darker. So that's a reflection of the Supreme Purnam, Krishna. 1 + 1 = 1, 1 - 1 = 1. He's always whole. So all sense of incompleteness in us is due to incomplete knowledge of him. Just like if my hand is disconnected from my body, then it may be called a hand, but it's not really a hand because it doesn't function as a hand. So for me to be a complete jiva in the sense of having all my qualities of jiva, which is the same as Krishna's qualities in tiny quantity, eternally eternal, blissful, full of knowledge, anandam udivardhanam. Even though I'm insignificant and tiny, my ananda is unlimited when I'm connected with the complete whole. So all sense of incompleteness is due to incomplete knowledge, and that means realized knowledge.
Yeah, my mistake was I was trying to connect this with the humility, but that's different.
This is an inconceivable thing. Like how Radharani can be the most humble. Humility and prem are synonymous. Like Gurudev said, the coward boys, each coward boy could kill a Kamsa, could kill an Agasura. But their prem gives them so much humility that they just depend on Krishna and wait for him to do it. And then they don't even think he's God after he does it. So that kind of humility that you find in Radharani, that you find in Madhya Yasoda, one drop of her breast milk is the Kiradak ocean, the ocean of milk that Kiradakshai Vishnu lies in. But she doesn't think of herself as anything. So real humility is consistent with praying, and I can't conceive how Krishnadas Kaviraj could say that, how he's so low, and they really believe it. If somebody can answer that, it's just an inconceivable thing. How that sense of insignificance and the sense of Krishna is everything, Radharani is everything, and I have no interest in my own pleasure at all. It fits with that. It's worth it for me to. It doesn't bring me any happiness to try for my own pleasure, to think about myself. because I'm insignificant, but Radha's my everything, Krishna's my everything. Does that help at all?
Something else came up was that I've heard that true humility is service. So why cowherd boys couldn't serve Krishna and kill Kamsa? Why were they waiting for Krishna to do this?
Like with Hanuman. Hanuman is so humble, but he attacks all Lanka. But the cowherd boys, as you were explaining, they are so humble, they don't even attack Kamsa. Because he wants to kill Krishna. Why is that?
I understand the question. I don't understand the answer, except that they're acting as ordinary boys. They don't do things out of the ordinary. They just act as ordinary coward boys. Like, even when they're doing something that in their mind is like, we have to hold up the hill to help Krishna because he's getting tired, and so they hold up the hill. They think they're holding up the hill with their sticks, but still they're thinking that it's not a big deal. They're just always thinking as ordinary coward boys.
I had an idea that that's because it was Krishna's will that Krishna do these things. And perhaps there's a difference between serving Krishna directly and doing what we think is serving.
Very good, thank you. Like, their service is not like Hanuman's service, like Vrajanashvaka mentioned. His service and his humility is burning down Lanka, because he's in that kind of dasya ras. But the coward boy's service is another thing. It's joking, it's challenging Krishna, and maybe Krishna has to take them on his shoulders if they win. Or like Sridham. Sridham was having a wrestling match with Krishna, and Sridham won. Krishna was down and Sridham was up. So Sridham said, "I won." And Krishna said, "No, I won." Meanwhile, Krishna's flat on his back. And Sridham said, "How did you win?" So Krishna said, "Because my nose is up and your nose is down." So that's the kind of service.
Some of them are also bodyguards.
Bodyguards, but they won't do anything to the demons. Like Madhu Mangal, he's in the cowherd ras as a friend, and you know the story when he was thinking, well, Krishna gets all the popularity and all the nice things to eat just because he's wears the peacock feather and plays the flute and wears the yellow garments. It's not really Krishna's credit. So if I would wear them, then I would get all the popularity and the nice things to eat. So he asked Krishna if he could have his clothes and flute and peacock feather, and Krishna gave it to him. And just at that time, the Keshi demon came. And by the Keshi demon's mirror, he didn't touch Madhu Mangal, just the air that he blew knocked him far away. And then Madhu Mangal said, "Thanks anyway, but you keep your peacock feather and flute." So they can, but they don't think like that they can, because their service is different. It's joking, it's playing, it's challenging Krishna. Like, it's feeding Krishna, it's being fed by Krishna. It's a different kind of service. Do you want to add anything?
Mainly in past time, so Krishna told, "Jog Maya Koribe Apon Prabhave." Krishna has given the remote control to control his past time in the hand of Jog Maya Devi. So Jog Maya make them forget, "I am so powerful of this and that." So they never think, "I am powerful, I can do that." Jog Maya make them forget. So they don't know what is going on. And for Kaviraj Goswami, this is humility. He is not wretched than this and that. Like Srimati Radha Thakurani telling, "Na prema gandhasti darapi me harau, krandami saubhagya bharam prakashitum, vamsi vilasavalokanam vina vibhar mijat pranapratanga kan vitha." Radhika weeping and telling, oh, I have not even any pinch of love for Krishna. No prema gandha spina smell of prem. So Krishna, why that weeping? Radhika, I am weeping? Then Radhika telling, Sobhagva Bharam Prakashitum. I want to show you how fortunate I am weeping for Krishna to show you all. Hide her mood. So if I have love, then if you want to see love between fish and water, if you take fish out of water, fish will die. But still, without seeing the face of Krishna, I am maintaining my prem. This is humility. Same way, Kaviraj Goswami, Puri said, Kit haite mui se logista, jagai madai haite mui se papi. So this is natural humility.
It's quite inconceivable.
Yeah.
We can't even imagine.
Look how automatic, not artificial.
Yeah. And then in that verse that Shripad Madan Maharaj is quoting, Mahaprabhu is saying that verse in the mood of Radharani.
Yes.
And he ends by saying, Patanga Khan, I'm maintaining my life just like an insect. My life is worth the life of an insect. Yeah. Can't conceive.
This slok only uttered by Sriman Mahaprabhu and Radhika, no one else.
Yeah. We can imagine, but it's about it. So we'll end on that happy note. And Gaur Premanandi Hari Hari Bol. Shula Bhakti Vinod Thakur Ki Jai. Shula Bhajan Rahasya Ki Jai. Shula Gurudeva Ki Jai.
Hare 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 Hare